Hi everyone, this is Jerry. Thank you so much for watching. In this video, I'm going to present Schumann's Kreisligiana, Opus 16. I have to apologize in advance. If there's some weird sounds coming out in this video, that's because my microphone is kind of broken. First and foremost, please allow me to give you a brief summary of what you can learn from watching this video. For methods, I'm mainly using literature review to conduct this research combined with score study and recording analysis. In this video, I'm aiming to go over at least three major components. The first one is the background and the programmatic connotation. In this section, I'm going to go over some historical context of the piece itself, and then moving to the relationship between E.T.A. Hoffmann and Schumann and how the formal influenced the latter in writing this music. Then we're going to move into explore the relationship between music and literature, especially in the Romantic period. The second component is going to be a high-level analysis of all eight pieces, especially the concept of the Romantic suite and understanding how Schumann put his alter ego Florestan and Eusebius in writing this music. The third component is just going to be highlights of each movement. Kreisligiana is an early work of Robert Schumann. It was originally written in 1838 when Schumann was 28 years old. However, it is still regarded as one of the best Schumann's pieces for piano. It was written and dedicated to Frédéric Chopin. This piece is very dramatic in nature and consists of eight movements that are constructing to each other. Here's a fun fact. Although we oftentimes regard Chopin as the main figure of the Romantic season and Schumann as the early figure of the Romantic period, however, both the composers were born in the same year of 1810. If we recall the knowledge we learned from music theory and piano literature, Beethoven and other early Romantic composers were introduced to the idea of the programmatic themes. Schumann was one of them. It was very common for musicians in the Romantic period to derive inspiration from the interrelationship between music, literature, fantasy, and philosophy. Among many figures, E.T.A. Hoffmann was a big influence on Schumann's composition. As a German Romantic author of fantasy, Hoffmann produced many works, including the very famous Nutcracker and the Mouse Game, which inspired Tchaikovsky to finish his ballet. Hoffmann also, in his other novels, created a fictional figure named Kessler, an emotional, occupied, moody musician who's in a constant internal conflict with the current reality. If you can look at the bottom of the page, here is Hoffmann's portrayal of the figure Kessler by the author himself. Based on what we learned from the piano literature lecture, I think it is not hard to see the clear parallel between Kessler and Schumann himself. Indeed, the collection of Kreisligiana is based on this very clever yet a social musician. And if you look at the very bottom of this page, Schumann actually wrote a letter to his friend and commented that Kessler is an eccentric, wild, clever conductor. Kreisligiana is a collection of eight pieces, unified under one common theme. Someone could probably argue that it is a romantic suite, which is different from the Baroque suite. In the earlier times, suite is composed of many dances, such as Allemande or Sarabande. Although we will see some dancing elements in Kreisligiana, but the dances are not that essential to this collection. Instead, what unify the suite are three other elements. First, a centralized topic that governs all separate pieces. Second, the very close key relationship between each movement. If you take a close look at the summary of the keys, at least in the image here, you will notice that almost all keys are closely related to each other. And third, There are many recycled rhythm and melodic contour recurring over and over again to unify the collection. Here is the overview of 8 pieces that are created for you. From a glimpse, I think you will notice that each movement is alternating between a fast, animated mood and a slow, inwardly gesture, which is clearly connected to Schumann's alternating egos of passionate Florestan and reflective Eusebius. Furthermore, Schumann in his collection utilized many polyphonic compositions, Baroque dances, and multi-voiced lyricism as a result of the Bach revival. We will dive into those in details later. In the next part, we're going to explore some highlights and signature composition techniques of Schumann in each piece. Unfortunately, Schumann didn't give each work a unique title, so I will refer to them by number. The first work is written in D minor and extremely animated. It has the expanded tenor form, which consists of toccata, allemande, and toccata as the ABA sections. Let us listen to the opening section first. And I do hope we can at least recognize one signature move of Schumann in this section. I think many of you already noticed the signature move of Schumann in this opening section is the usage of syncopation. The lack of downbeat almost gave the piece and relentless energy to move forward. The second point is the theme of Clara, which is the descending 4 or 5 note patterns that Schumann oftentimes uses in his composition. So the theme of Clara starts with a G, moving to F and to E flat, to D, and then end up on C. Let's listen to it first. Actually, we're going to encounter the theme of Clara multiple times in the later section too. The number 2 is written in B flat major, a very inwardly mood. For the form, I was debating between expanded ternary and rondo, but in the end, I decided to go with the 5-part rondo. It's modulated from B flat major to its dominant, going back and moving into relative G minor and ending on the B flat major. Let us listen to the recording first. One thing worthy of pointing out is that Schumann utilized the polyphonic technique in constructing this melodic contour, and you can definitely hear some counterpoint in the section A. Let's move to the first intermezzo in F major. I think just from the glimpse, we can tell this intermezzo is very dramatically different from the section A. And the second intermezzo is even more interesting, filled with the dotted rhythm, which we know is one signature rhythm pattern of Schumann. But also more interestingly, it's written in G minor. And I think if we can we just hold the establishment of G minor in our mind while listening to this section? The reason why the G minor was very special is because the G minor section in number 2 was a foreshadowing of the number 3, which is a scale in a ternary form, modulating between like G minor and its relative major key. For this movement, we first hear about the usage of intense triplet, which we'll repeat in the later section. Let us to hear it first. And clearly the left hand is in an enlarged dot rhythm. And the second point is the polyphonic texture and the words moving. The first time I heard it, although it's much more lyrical than Bach's pieces, but I do feel like this polyphonic texture brought me back to some of the Bach's writing, especially when the new voice entering, while the old voice didn't just die out, but instead continue and moving forward. The third point would be the tonal shift between major and minor modes. We were exposed to the fact that Schubert actually was a big fan of such technique, but so did Schumann, clearly represented in this section. We're going to listen to it. In piece number 4, we go back to the reflective side of Schumann, a very slow movement written in B flat major and G minor, a rather traditional ternary ABA form. In the opening material, we can discern many compositional elements of Schumann, such as syncopation in both hands, the theme of Clara in the outline, and the improvisatory nature. Let's hear it first. And just to make it clear, the theme of the Clara in this open section would be the D and C, C, B flat, A, and G. Next, in our contrasting section, it is astonishing how Schumann delineates multiple voices that are independent of each other, moving in very different directions. The soprano and bass line are almost moving in the contrasting direction. It's kind of the counterpoint technique we learned in music theory. The fifth is a very lively G minor piece written in the form of scherzo and trio. The scherzo itself could be interpreted as a small tenor with ABA structure. However, the middle trio is new material and then goes back to the scherzo again, but with theme B appearing first, almost in a reversed order. That's very interesting. The beginning is filled with dotted rhythm and a quick sequence. Let us listen to it first. Here Here, I would like to do a short comparison between number 3 and number 4 of this current piece. Here's number 3 again. And here's number 5. Put aside the differences, the repeated usage of triplet definitely interconnect those two pieces together well. And the third point of this section would be the middle trill. Let's just listen to it first. What struck me here is the repeated usage of sequins, which is similar to the opening material of the number 5 of current piece. Okay, so let's move on to the number 6. The next one is very slow movement again, written in B flat major. For the form, I was debating between like a binary and ternary, but since the repeated section A is so short, it's just like a few measures, I think it is binary form. At the beginning, this work presents a very concise motif. I can demonstrate here. Very, very concise motif, which is almost one measure long here, if you can see. It appears in the auto line first, and then moving to the tenor in the second measure, and the bass, still in the tenor, the third measure, but it will move to bass later on. Let's listen to it first. The reason why we listen to this section so long is just because I want to point out the very fast passage here, which almost reminds me of a playing of a harpsichord, like a baroque instrument as opposed to piano playing. Next, I want to point out the range of the main theme. Like Beethoven, Schumann utilized the wide range of the keyboard that he had, and was not shy from moving the theme entry to a very low register, which is normally reserved for accompaniment. Let's hear it. And if you can see the screen here, the theme is in the very, very low bass here. I think it's very rare to see a Baroque or a classic composer would move the theme or melody into this low of the register. The last point I want to make in this piece is the climax is actually set at the very end. Very romantic compositional choice. So basically, the climax is only like a few measures from the end of the entire piece. The number 7 is an extended scherzo and show form. The key moves between C and G minor and E flat major, all are closely related to each other. From my personal perspective, this music is probably the most demanding of all works in the collection regarding techniques. The running passage never stops until the very last few measures, reminding me of the third movement of Beethoven's Appassionata Sonata. The melodic contour fits well with the theme of Clara. Let's hear it. The final movement is written in G minor, with a fast and playful mood, which breaks the alternating pattern of Florestan and Eusebius. Although I'm not entirely sure, I believe it is a five-part rondo, mainly centering around the modulation between G minor and its relative major keys. One thing that struck me is the usage of multi-rhythmic pattern at the very beginning. The contrast between 6/8 and syncopation is prominent. Let's hear it. As you can see, the rhythmic pattern is rather sophisticated, and actually Schumann expands on this multi-rhythmic pattern and does some variation in the later section too. Let's hear it. As you can hear, the syncopation is reserved, but there's other elements added into the section. The last point I want to make is, again, like his contemporaries, Schumann utilized the modal shift between minor and major to emphasize the internal shift of mood, and here's a section that amazed me. I was very impressed by the smooth transition from very clearly minor key and suddenly just become a major key. Thank you so much for watching. Here's my works cited page. I derive most of the insights from these works, especially the historical context and the programmatic connotation. Also, if anyone wants to dive deeper into this collection, I would highly, highly recommend reading Mara Ostdorf's paper. I think it's the second one here. She wrote her entire dissertation on this collection, including but not limited to formal and pedagogical analysis. My presentation heavily relies on her insights. Have a wonderful day!